This is the Share the Knowledge Podcast for DJs. Today's podcast is brought to you by Banzoogle. All right, I see another comment here for my setting cue points for your whole music collection, and that's also a podcast episode. And the comment is, setting cue points in advance is an opportunity for you to really get to know the tracks you're adding to your collection as you're listening to them. Since, as TLM said in other videos, it's crucial to know the music you intend to play. I usually set a cue point on the first beat, another one on the last beat of the intro for me to quickly see if the intro is 4 bars or 8 bars long. That's dope. But you see that at a glance on the waveform anyway. Then I do the same thing on the first and second hook. For me to know where to start my transition, whether I decide to let the song play until the first or second hook, depending on whether the audience is really feeling the track. So in this case, really using the cue points as a visual marker, not just the point where you can go to real quick, but using the cue points as a visual marker is a very smart tactic, especially for songs that you don't know that well. Then that visual indicator can really help you out. I also like the fact that you're talking about the first beat and that last beat before the new phrase begins, where mostly the verse will begin. Because yes, some intros will be only 4 bars, some will be 8 bars. And you can tell by looking at the waveform, but having that extra visual cue point can be a nice addition. All right, I guess you play a song without putting any cue points in it, but you gotta know that the song, you gotta know that song by heart. So you might wanna put cue points in it anyway as you're practicing, because if not, like someone else said in the comments, what's the point of playing digitally? Yeah, true. I mean, there's a lot of songs that I know by heart, but in that case, I still have cue points in there, not as a visual indicator, but because I want to be able to work fast. And if I know, like the first beat, I always have that, just because if I'm beat matching and I have it synced, I want to go back to the beginning with a push of a button instead of having to rewind the record or lifting up the needle. So that's a important cue point for me. Then there might be other parts in the track that I just want to go to quick, and that's why I have cue points in there, even if it's a track that I know by heart. The main goal of cue points is to move fast while you're DJing. Your time is limited when you're spinning and you want to move quick, so a lot of things are going to happen that will slow you down. You're beat matching and want to get to the beginning of the song again. Yes, that's what I just said. Exactly. You were going to play a song but realize it doesn't fit the ambiance. Your track skipped and you do want to start it over. A special part in the song comes up for which you have a little cue point juggle. Yep, all of that. But also, a member of staff comes and talks to you. A customer comes to request a song. You say hi to your friends. Some flirtatious chick comes to talk to you, etc., etc. You want to be able to move as fast as you can to reduce reaction time and lower the stress that comes from adapting to an unexpected situation. That's a very good point, because especially if you're not used to playing in front of people yet, you need to realize that once you get into the scenario of playing in front of people where people have access to you, it means that a lot of people are going to have a chance to disturb, disrupt, or at least get in your workspace while you're attempting to perform. Some mean well. Some are very egoistic and they are just thinking about themselves, and some actually don't mean well at all. Whatever the case may be, people could disturb your set. So in that case, cue points can definitely help out as well. I've been in a situation where someone was really distracting right before I wanted to make a transition. I had to brush them off quick, then jump back to the set. If at that point I had to manually bring back the vinyl, bring back the needle, look for the beginning, I would not be in time for the transition. In this case, I brushed the person off, ran back to the set, hit my cue point to go back to that first beat because I only had like 3 more counts before the hook started, hit that cue point, and I was able to just bring it in just in time for the transition. Without cue points, that would not be possible. And I've been in plenty of situations before my digital time where I was using vinyl where something like that happened, and then I missed my window, and then I had to wait an entire other verse before I could do my transition in the next hook. And that was always pretty frustrating. So cue points can really help you out. Same thing with like short loops that you can activate at any point. Stuff like that can help you out if you run into situations like that. So it's always good to hear from actual experienced DJs, because I can recognize a lot of the things he's talking about. And that's what I love about the modern technology. I don't feel it takes over the DJ's job in any way. I feel it makes our job easier, because we had to deal with situations in the past that went beyond our control. And I have no desire to keep it real for some of these purists and continue to live in those circumstances when there's no need to. Same thing with needles that used to skip. Now, if you play with Serato or DJ software and you have it in relative mode, the skips don't affect your track the way they did. Now, is that a skill factor? No, it's not. I played in clubs where you had like this unsteady stage, and anytime someone would touch the DJ booth, your record would skip. And this was a place where people were leaning up against the DJ booth, so a lot of times your records would skip. Now, that's not something I want to continue to happen, but at that particular venue, it would always happen. Now, with Serato, that changed the situation. Even if the record would skip, the music would continue to play straight away. It was less of an issue compared to when your needle on normal vinyl skips and now you're all the way back to the beginning of the song, or you're in the next song, the whole vibe is dead. You have to lift the needle up, no sound, bring it back to the beginning. That's an awful situation. There's no way I would continue to play and risk that if I don't have to, because that's not taking away anything from your skills. That's why it's so tiring to talk to certain people about technological development, because they feel that now it's all about the technology and not about the skill. But a lot of these things had nothing to do with skill at all. So, yeah, man, it's perfect to have stuff like that. And that's a very good use of cue points. So thank you for that comment. You just checked out a video clip from my Share the Knowledge podcast for DJs. I drop a new podcast every Monday, and you can check out the full audio episodes by clicking on the links in the description box down below. Now, most weeks I will ask people for topics for the podcast, but sometimes I see questions later on asking me if I've already made a video. So I just want to make it clear for you here on YouTube, my podcast is an audio podcast. That's a full podcast that I drop every week. From that podcast, I might take a couple of questions and turn those into videos. But if you want to make sure you don't miss out on any of the topics, check me out. My podcast is everywhere. Anchor, SoundCloud, Spotify, Apple, Google Podcasts, Stitcher, Podbean, you name it. Click on the links to follow. Check out sharethenowledgepodcast.com. That's the podcast website. And yeah, of course, if you're new to my YouTube channel, make sure you subscribe, activate notifications, and all that good stuff. If you like the video, make sure you like it, share it, share the knowledge. I'll be back soon. Thanks for watching. Bandzoogle makes it easy to build a stunning website for your music in minutes. You can choose from hundreds of mobile-friendly themes and then customize your design and content in a few clicks with Bandzoogle's easy visual editor. Now, all the features you need for a professional website are already built in, including tools to sell your music and merch commission-free, mailing list tools to grow your fan list and send newsletters, and integration to pull in content from all your online services, including Twitter, Instagram, and SoundCloud. I use Bandzoogle to create the Share the Knowledge podcast website, and that was very easy. Bandzoogle plans start at just $8.29 a month and include your own free custom domain name. Now, if you want to try it out for free for 30 days, click on the link in the description box down below and be sure to use the promo code SHARE to get 15% off the first year of your subscription.